Good afternoon. Well, first to the international emergency unfolding in India that has forced our Prime Minister to act. Australia will close its border to India for at least the next 2 weeks. It is a story breaking this afternoon as we go to air, and federal politics reporter Emma LaRouche has the details. Emma, good afternoon to you. It is a very tough call because this decision will leave vulnerable Australians stuck.
Good afternoon, Davina. That's right. Those hoping to fly home from India will have to wait, with a suspension of flights in place until the 15th of May. These are direct passenger services that were due to come in from India, and that decision has been made by the federal government's National Security Committee earlier today. There are more than 8,000 Australians in India, and the Foreign Minister said there were 8 repatriation flights scheduled for next month, which are now on hold. Maurice Payne describing the situation as a very difficult time. The Prime Minister also said indirect flights through other cities like Doha, Singapore and Kuala Lumpur have been paused by their respective governments. And this all comes after National Cabinet had last week agreed to a 30% reduction in commercial and charter flights. The federal government insists tougher measures would only be imposed based on health advice. India's health system is at breaking point, and Scott Morrison described the situation there as heartbreaking, also announcing an aid package. And it means Australia will join several other nations like the United States in offering humanitarian assistance, as Aussies desperately trying to flee the situation won't be able to get out for at least 2 weeks.
We are standing with those Australians in India and recognise the very serious difficulties that they face. This is an initial package. There will be more to follow of support, and to deliver this as soon as possible. So 500 non-invasive ventilators, 1 million surgical masks, 500,000 P2 and N95 masks, 100,000 surgical gowns, 100,000 goggles, 100,000 pairs of gloves, and 20,000 face shields. We will also agree to commence procurement of 100 oxygen concentrators, along with tanks and consumables.
Regarding the flight's decision, the PM added that it had been made to ease the burden on Darwin's Howard Springs quarantine facility, as well as New South Wales quarantine, due to the number of positive COVID cases in travellers returning from India. Davina?
Emma, thank you. And the Prime Minister has said he has no sympathy for the Australian cricketers who are now trapped in India. As we go to air, several stars, including Steve Smith, Glenn Maxwell and Pat Cummins, have indicated they will remain in the country for the current IPL season.
They've travelled there privately under those arrangements. This wasn't part of an Australian tour, and they're under their own resources, and they'll be using those resources to, I'm sure, to see them return to Australia in accordance with their own arrangements.
Other top players, Adam Zampa, Kane Richardson and Andrew Tye, have already returned home, cutting their lucrative IPL season short. Well, the European Union is suing AstraZeneca over an alleged breach of its vaccine supply contract. The EU ordered 30 million jabs to be delivered by June, but the pharmaceutical company will deliver just a third of that. AstraZeneca has since denied any breaches in their contract. The United States is preparing to send up to 60 million AstraZeneca doses to countries in need. President Joe Biden has signed off on the offer, but the final tick of approval must come from the Food and Drug Administration. No word yet on which countries will receive those doses. A lawyer for Ghislaine Maxwell says the accused sex trafficker is using a sock as an eye mask to shield from prison guard flashlights, which are shone in her cell every 15 minutes. Defence attorneys argued that sleep deprivation is hurting her trial preparations, and they want her released on bail. Prosecutors say the routine checks are necessary to make sure Maxwell doesn't die in jail, in the same way her confidant Jeffrey Epstein did. We'll try to squeeze a square peg in a round hole and it doesn't fit. And the same can be said for a giant truck that tried to ram its way under a railway bridge in Brisbane. Shannon Marshall-McCormack was there for the crash that proved to be a commuter nightmare.
Well, it's a massive crash that's closed Oxley Road at Corinda for hours now. A semi-trailer striking the rail overpass bridge at around 5 a.m. this morning, closing the rail line between Corinda and Moorooka. Traffic had to be diverted around the rail overpass during peak hour. There are rail warning lights that would have warned the driver that their truck was too large. Witnesses say they woke to an almighty bang and ran out to see if the driver was okay.
I just woken up and I was having a cup of coffee, and I hear this humongous crash.
I heard sirens earlier on. I thought, shit, what the hell? And I come out and saw all the commotion.
It's been there for about 130 years, but some people seem to miss it.
Now, while this rail line has been closed for several hours, fortunately, it only carries freight. They are now in the process of removing the semi-trailer from the impacted bridge, but it's expected to remain closed for hours while engineers inspect it to see if they can reopen the train line.
Anxiety levels are on the rise, with online help services busier than ever before. And psychologists say young professionals are responsible for that alarming spike. Catherine Foran explains.
7 a.m. has been labelled stress o'clock by psychologists who say more people are reaching out for help before work than ever before. Text-based counselling service Virtual Psychologist has seen a 74% spike in demand, mostly by those aged in their 20s and 30s feeling too anxious to go to work. The service allows Australians to connect to a qualified counsellor 24 hours a day by sending text messages. According to founder Dervla Lochney, many people are reaching out first thing after having a sleepless night.
7 o'clock is a really busy time for us. We're getting a lot of to and fro messages. For a lot of people, they've been awake throughout the night and they've been worrying about things. And the first thing they do when they wake up in the morning is make a decision to actually do something about their worries.
The service has seen an increase since COVID-19 as people who have been working from home return to the office. According to data, men and women aged between 30 and 40 are more likely to reach out later in the day between 10 o'clock and 11.
So they're making it into the workplace, but then choosing the first coffee break to reach out to us and saying, hey, I'm just not coping.
Psychologists are urging anyone who might be struggling to reach out for help.
UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson has denied shocking claims. He told aides last year he'd rather bodies pile high in their thousands than impose a second COVID lockdown. Here's our Europe correspondent, Ben Avery.
Well, the comment was allegedly made here within the walls of Downing Street. According to reports, Boris Johnson told colleagues he'd rather let bodies pile high in their thousands than impose another COVID-19 lockdown. Several media outlets, including the BBC, say they've spoken to two separate sources who claim they heard the comment, which was allegedly made before England's second national lockdown and as the Prime Minister discussed the prospects of a third.
I was astonished to see those words. It's for the Prime Minister, I think, now to make a public statement about that. If he did say those things, then he's got to explain it.
At a public engagement, Boris Johnson was asked about the claim, which he denied.
Have you ever said that you'd rather see bodies pile up and go into another third lockdown?
No.
But there were more questions in UK Parliament, with Minister Michael Gove forced to defend the Prime Minister.
The idea that he would say any such thing, I find incredible. I was in that room. I never heard language of that kind.
This only adds to the pressure on Boris Johnson, who's facing a review into how an expensive refurbishment of his apartment here on Downing Street was paid for. That follows claims from his former adviser, Dominic Cummings, that he once planned to have party donors secretly foot the bill.